What's up, everybody? Welcome to episode 17 of the Council. You should know the name of this show by now, 17 episodes in. I got Gabe joining me again, and Strykie, but we've got Falkunn making his first appearance on the show.
Hello.
How's it going, man?
Not too bad, thank you. How about yourself?
Going good, going good. Just taking it easy this Saturday. Just chilling. Not really doing much. Watching videos of Broodmother winning a tournament, because that happened.
Because Broodmother, boys.
Brood mother. But we can talk about D'Vorah. She's on our list. Let's get cracking. Let's get on with our topics, guys. So we had the third Alpha Blood tournament a couple of weeks ago. I think it was a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, the 6th of September.
6th of September.
Yeah,
so a couple of weeks ago. See, I even know the dates. I'm prepared today. And we Strykie and Falkunn were at. So Falkunn, you haven't been on the show before. Just kick it off and talk about the tournament a little bit. You did pretty well at this tournament, so walk us through it. I hear like, there's some logistics with kind of getting people there, from what I heard. It was kind of a pain in the ass.
Yeah, there were some problems along the central line because of, engineering work. So, we didn't actually know about that. I went with my friend Kirby because we live together, and he's been playing with me for about the past, how long? 3 weeks, maybe? And he doesn't play competitive fighting games in the slightest, doesn't play MK. And he went over there. He came fifth, so I'm like, that's pretty good.
Nice. Who does he use?
He was using Relentless Jason at the time, but he's made the switch over to Sun God Kotal Kahn.
Good switch.
And overall, I mean, the tournament didn't have the biggest turnout because of all the travel problems. The twins couldn't make it down. There were some other people who couldn't make it due to like prior arrangements or something. Mm-hmm. So it ended up with a few players of like the London area. Then we had Strykie, we had TQT, Gap Standard, and just Kirby and some others. Overall, I mean, like, it went rather well. It ends up coming down to me playing Strykie in winner's finals. It was his Ninjutsu Scorpion versus my Kobujutsu Tanya. And, Strykie, did you take the first game on me or the second?
I took the first game, yeah.
The first game, yeah?
Made some good adjustments. Go on.
I'll tell you one thing. You cannot throw a projectile at Strykie. You can't do it because you will just die. I think the mistake.
Tanya's projectile is pretty slow too. Like it's
decent, but I made the mistake because I was like mid screen. Like I was close enough for me to have just thrown it, and then him to have just respected it and blocked it. But he reacted like lightning quick, and then just EX teleported me. So either like he read me or he just reacted like a god. But he just destroyed me in that first game. So I had to really like just cool myself off, make sure I'm listening to the right genre of music. You know, hype myself up. And then just play through with it. But overall, I think that was probably the most fun match I had that tournament, if anything. It really stretched me. So, like, props to you, Strykie. It was a good set. Gabe. The Gap Standard knocked TQT into losers. What was it? It was 2-1, wasn't it?
Yep.
And then you guys played again in loser semis?
Yes.
And then he beat you, and then it ended up being Strykie versus TQT in loser's finals. TQT ended up prevailing in the match, fought me in grand finals, reset the bracket. He was playing Grandmaster Sub-Zero. I didn't play Tanya, because I wouldn't really want to play Tanya onto GM Sub-Zero, for obvious reasons. I didn't want to have to use meter to really get myself out of a corner situation with the clone up and, you know, things like that. Or for me to, like, say, for example, I was going to try and jump or, like, telly out the corner. He's just going to back to me or something. So it's just clone pressure. I didn't want to deal with that. I just used Hishkiten Predator. And it ended up going 3-2. He reset the bracket against me. And I was just thinking to myself, okay, well, if my Predator can't do it, I don't want to play this matchup with Tanya. I'm going to just go back to Kenshi and see how it does. Because I know Kenshi, it's quite a favorable matchup for him. And then I ended up winning that 3-1 or 3-0, I can't remember.
Was that a balanced Kenshi? Or...
That was balanced, yeah. So I generally did the whole, like, you know, the typical mid-screen, keep yourself in shoulder range, either run in and back three them, grab them, or just shoulder them. Mm-hmm. You just have that threat. So, I mean, it's all I really could do every time. TQT likes to jump. He likes to jump, so I just always made sure I had meter. Like every single knockdown, just two whiffed shoulders, built myself up some meter, just gradually kept it up. So every time he jumps in on me, or every time he's gonna do something, I'm just gonna EX Rising Karma. Mm-hmm. If he's gonna throw out a clone, I'm just gonna shoulder charge him, and I ended up winning like that. So, I mean, overall, it was a pretty decent tournament. It was fun. We got loads of casuals in. It did run a bit late because of all the travel stuff, giving some time to people trying to turn up and whatnot. Oh, yeah, Luckbox did go as well from Legacy of Mines.
Who did he use?
He used Reptile. Did he used Nimble, didn't he?
Yeah, for some reason, he's not too big on the Deceptive. Buffs.
Yeah, it's strange. I think it's because he can't see himself.
So, Nimble's the one with the Flash's trait, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right, pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, there's no pretty much, it's Flash's trait. I mean, let's be serious. It's cool, but, you know, it is just Flash's trait. Why does Reptile have that? Like,
because he's nimble.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's not really what... Yeah,
he
nimble
can slow down
can
time.
Slow down time.
Yeah, man, maybe he's actually an Elder God, but Nether Realm actually didn't release that information to us.
Maybe so. Did TQT go Sub-Zero the whole set?
He did. He went Grandmaster Sub-Zero for the first two games, then he switched over to Cryomat. No, wait. I think he used GM Sub first.
For the last game against you, he went...
He went Cryomancer, didn't he? Yeah, he went Cryomancer. Yeah. But due to the nature of the untrue block string of like the down four hammer, he did that, just EX Rising Karma in between it, and then just ended him like that.
Yeah, down four hammer seems a bit gimmicky.
But overall, I mean, like, the damage you can get with Cryomancer is ridiculous. Get one back two off in mid-screen, just run in, forward four two, stab EX Hammer, 4-4-2 hammer, it's like 43%. And then off a double back two in the corner, you can do the same thing and get 47%. It's crazy.
Yeah, he hits pretty hard now. They end in a restand, don't they, too, his combos?
The stab does.
Yeah.
That's but what I mean. You can, yeah, special cancel it. And the hammer is just a hard knockdown.
Yeah, the hammer itself is like plus 32, so you get like a pseudo safe jump. Like, you can go for the air hammer and armor break, so on and so forth.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Anything else from the tournament? I know it was a like, fairly small turnout, so anything else?
Yeah,
you want to talk
I mean,
about?
There weren't many people that were able to turn up. So it was the turnout wasn't amazing, but the thing is, like, everyone got to play casuals against everyone, so it was overall, it was just really fun.
Yeah, that's always the plus side about those tournaments. Like, even though the amount of players isn't that high, you get to play a lot. So you get to, like, kind of grind any matchups, hopefully, that you want to grind out and get some more experience in.
I didn't actually play Tanya the entire tournament. I played Tanya only against Strykie. Mm-hmm. Even though I main Tanya, I didn't actually want to play her in the other matches because I kind of wanted to just I wanted to hold on to it, I guess. I wanted to use a character that I felt I was fairly decent with, and then if that lost, I would switch over to Tanya because I guess I kind of wanted to put myself in a tournament environment, you know, under that stress, under the pressure of playing like that. And then with different matchups to see how I fared with them, just to improve.
Yeah.
In a way. So I ended up playing Hollywood Cassie Cage against everyone else.
Hollywood. So you didn't feel good. So you didn't feel good with Daniel. That makes me feel good losing to you, man. Thanks.
I'm better with Tanya. But the thing is, I wanted to improve my Cassie Cage. So I didn't play Cassie against you. I played Tanya against you. I was like, you are not getting my Cassie. You need 100% for me. Like, literally 110%. I struggled so much that entire set. I had, like, a vein in my forehead. I was like, I can't slip up. If I drop one thing, he's going to murder me. You've stepped up so much, though. Like, a lot. You've gotten really, really good. So it's, like, it's hard playing against you. Really hard.
It might have been because I went, like, ninjutsu mainly for the tournament.
Yeah.
People seem very unfamiliar with ninjutsu.
Like, I only know a bit of ninjutsu from watching MIT play it, but... Yeah.
People seem very unfamiliar with it.
Yeah, that's true.
Which
I
is
mean,
good in a lot of ways, because it's one of those variations where if you're not familiar with its range... Because like, I think that's why people might be unfamiliar with it, because you don't typically think of Scorpion as having range, and then when you fight him and all of a sudden, you know, he can hit you from, like, you know, half the screen away, it's like, oh, shit. Like, you know, you have to kind of look into that a bit. For sure. Gabe, anything you want to touch on about the tournament?
Falkunn more or less covered most of it. I would say, though, matches against TQT, which, by the way, I think he's actually improved quite a lot from when I first played him in... When did I first play him? I think it was Alpha Blood 1 is when I first played him.
Yeah,
because TQT used to block pressing a lot of buttons, put that way. Whenever you're knocking down, he'd always like wake up slide or always do it overhead while still playing like at 100 miles an hour. Now he still plays at that relentless pace, but he's a lot more harder to read because he's a lot more sensible, I guess, on knockdown, not waking up as often, being a bit more mix up heavy when he can as well. So credit to him for winning a run back, I guess. It did kind of piss me off.
Credit to him, I guess. Like, that's what that means.
Yeah. Well, it kind of annoyed me as well, because I really wanted to get top three in that tournament at the very lowest, and I came fourth, so
that's
a little bit of a stinger. But also, I have to give props to Strykie, because I think he played really, really well.
Yeah, I want to see Strykie, Scorpion. I know you don't really play online much, so like that's why it's kind of frustrating that like a lot of these tournaments don't have footage available for them, which is really annoying. I don't think that was this not even streamed as well?
It wasn't streamed. Yeah. April was really ill, so we couldn't have everything there to get the streaming equipment there and all that sort of jazz.
Yeah, that sucks.
It wasn't recorded as well, unfortunately. I kind of wish it was, because I like to look back at tournament gameplay and stuff and like analyze how I played and what mistakes I've made, etc., etc.
Yeah, so do I.
Yeah, so I guess mental note isn't too bad.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of it's an annoying chore to do, but like I feel like the only matches that are really worth watching are ones where you lose.
Yeah,
like,
true.
You're like, because I mean, watching ones where you win makes you feel better, but it's like you'll learn a lot more from the ones where you lose.
Yeah.
So, what else was there? That's about it for Alpha Blood, I guess. Unless you guys.
I will say just to touch on my performance.
Sure.
I did say for the most part I went ninjutsu. Mm-hmm. I think between everyone I played, Gabe did make the best adjustments, even though I did win. And I think there is a correlation for that, just because like his main training partners are Scorpion players.
Yeah, he plays me.
But,
yeah, I think, you know, Strykie, that's something actually I want to briefly touch on, seeing as you're pretty much the only other UK Scorpion. Do you find, like, because I know you're at Versus Fighting, when you play people offline, more often than not, it's like early in pools. Do you find people, like, play against Scorpion as if, like, they assume you're going to be, like, the typical online-ranked Scorpion, and then they find out very, very quickly that's not how you're playing, and they just have no idea what to do? That seems like a very common thing to come across in a tournament, like, in the UK. It's like, because we all know Scorpion is S+ online. Inferno is godlike. But, you know, that doesn't actually work. So when they come up against, like, you know, Hellfire or Ninjutsu, it's like they... I mean, I've played online a little bit, more on PC. I haven't fought, like, a Ninjutsu or Hellfire Scorpion yet. I fought plenty of Inferno Scorpions, but not a single Hellfire or Ninjutsu.
That's the Mitsu ones.
I haven't actually got Xbox One, so I haven't played them, but...
Yeah, I do agree with that. I think that's been a recurring theme behind, like, making Scorpion seem better than he actually is, just because people are, like, acquainted with Inferno, and then someone comes to their first offline tournament, they bump into a Hellfire, and they're like, yo, what the fuck is going on? I know nothing about this variation, and they get bought by Flame Aura, run cancels, so on and so forth.
As a Scorpion player, isn't that the best feeling in the world? You know when you get, like, when someone's just carelessly pressing buttons, and you Flame Aura them, and they're like, what the fuck is that?
And so the amount of times I got anti-air flame aura'd by Strykie.
Oh, it's the best feeling in the
either
world.
Either that, or if I down four and he's just out of range for it, and his flame aura hits me and it restands me, and I'm like, oh my god.
Nope.
I remember whiffing a back one, and he just ran up to me and flame aura'd, and it hit me.
Yeah, flame aura is amazing. Hitting people with that move, like when they, you know, when they're clearly unfamiliar with it, it's like the ultimate conditioning tool. Because if they show they're not familiar with it, then they just kind of stop doing anything, because, like, you know, the threat of getting hit by Flame Aura is like, oh god, I don't want to get hit by that. So they just kind of stop doing stuff, and then you can just kind of do whatever you want.
Yeah, as a Hellfire Scorpion player, I think hitting someone with Flame Aura is like the MK equivalent of an orgasm.
Yeah, yeah. Like, when someone, like, when you just do it, like, in the neutral on a read that they're going to do something, and whatever they do just, like, gets them into Flame Aura, it's like, yeah, hold that. it's like you tried to play footsies, you're about to lose 40% of your life. Sorry. Like, you really but, yeah. know have to. You really do know how to like have to deal with that if you aren't familiar with it. Go into training mode, study its range, study its properties. Contrary to what people think or might have told you, it's not still active after you block it. Which I don't really know why people think that, but yeah, you know, do your homework on Hellfire.
Otherwise, oh yeah, I made some enrage quit really casuals.
Wow, casuals blood. Really?
Yeah. I was playing Kotal Kahn against him, and I have a 46% one bar combo in the corner, and I hit him with it. I don't know what he did. I think he read I was gonna grab him on wake up, and I just back one. I did back 1-4 EX disc down 1-1-4 into the command grab, and it did 46%, and then he just gave up. And he just left. And I was like, oh.
Bad.
I felt really bad though.
I don't feel bad, man. It's a harsh world.
In this game, don't feel bad. Definitely don't feel bad. I actually love it when I make people angry when I play. That's why I like playing Venomous recently. Is just the best feeling in the world. God, people get pissed playing against that variation.
I like to showboat as much as I can in the middle of matches. It's not a good habit.
It's not if it loses you a match, then yeah, definitely. It's definitely not a good habit, but... anything else, guys, from Out for Blood that you want to touch on?
I'll just finish off by saying, like, I'm kind of glad I didn't go Hellfire against Gabe, because, to be honest, I probably would have lost. There's a problem with the run cancels post-patch. Like, the buffering's different.
They fixed that, though, didn't they? Or was that not fixed?
They made all cancels harder to do, didn't they?
Yeah,
yeah, they put it back, though. Like, that was changed in the patch, and then they hot-fixed it, and they put it back to normal.
Oh, it's I haven't actually played in 2 weeks. I've been away.
Yeah. That's a good point, though. When was the hotfix released?
It was the end of last month, and then the next day they released a hotfix to address the run cancel bug.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. I think where they've addressed all these option selects, you know, like Raiden's back 2 or Eren's forward 1-3, those kind of things.
Yeah.
I think the way they've tackled them, they've done part of the code that allows you to buffer run cancels. Because it's still happening to me. It was happening to me at Out for Blood. Like, I went Hellfire in my last game against Chev, and I noticed I was fucking up the cancels. Like, the fireball was just letting rip.
Did you Same make thing. Sure the hotfix was there?
That's, yeah, I checked the frame data on Quanchi's down 1. It was +3 on hit. Same thing was happening with TQT, which I wasn't happy about. Second game against him, I should have took, like, because... I knew he was going to try and jump out of the pressure. I did 2-1-4 fireball run cancel. He jumped out. I was going to jump kick him out of that accordingly, and the fireball just let ripped, and then it was curtains right there pretty much. So I was 2-0 down. I didn't know what the fuck was going on. I just pretty much pseudo rage quit and picked Inferno.
Oh, that's even worse.
Damn.
It's even worse.
Stakes are mid.
Yeah, I mean, there was definitely problems with it when it hit. Now they feel fine. And funnily enough, though, Honeybee mentioned something regarding D'Vorah's 1-1-2 Wasp Grenade cancel in Swarm Queen.
That's really hard. That's really, really hard now.
It's a hard link, yeah, but he mentioned that, like, you know, it's completely different. I'm not a Swarm Queen player, but it doesn't feel any different to me, I gotta admit.
Like, it does to me, because I started... playing D'Vorah a little bit before the patch came out. Mm-hmm. So obviously I got used to that run cancel, but since then with the hotfix, it still feels a bit off from what it used to be.
Yeah, I think the issue is it all depends how you and as a player do the run cancels.
Yeah.
It's like pre-patch, I did it in a position where I'm in a good position to convert on hit and take advantage of the plus frames and block. So maybe I just need to change that up now. Might just take some time to get used to the new buffering system or whatever it may be.
Yeah, I mean, Scorpions feel exactly the same now, like post-hotfix.
I will say this. Like, yep. I bet you won't be able to link from forward 4 on hit.
I've tried that a few times since the hotfix, and I actually haven't got it yet. So
neither have I.
Like, I don't know if that's actually possible anymore. Because it was hard before... But it was doable, like it wasn't impossible, whereas now it's like that just feels... It doesn't... You know like when you do cancel a move on hit, you can kind of feel the advantage. Like, that move now just doesn't feel like there is enough advantage to actually get a natural combo from it anymore.
Yeah, well, so, I think that's a prime example of what I'm stressing with, like, the way you can buffer it.
Yeah. Maybe it is just, like, really... Maybe even if it's only the difference of one frame, sometimes that is all it will take to, like, break something. So maybe that's what... I know when the patch first hit and I tried out Scorpion, I was, like, just ready to quit the game.
I remember.
Yeah, I was, like, tearing to Gabe so bad. I was like, this is fucking stupid. Like, they've nerfed the shit out of him again. Like, and, like, thankfully that was an error, because, like, it was stupid, like, what they did. I mean, obviously it was unintentional, but it was annoying that, like, you know, a patch kind of caused such a big rift in characters' playstyles. But yeah, that's pretty much it for Alpha Blood. I mean, we'll talk about the patch notes a bit in a bit if you want, guys. So moving on, our friends from across the pond had a pretty big major, TFC. You guys catch up on that?
I did.
What did you guys think about this tournament in general?
I only caught Grand Finals.
Okay. Strykie, what about you?
It wasn't too out of the ordinary, but it was good to see some lesser known faces and some lesser known characters in top 8, to say the least. Shout out to the Magician.
Yeah,
the Cassie Cage player, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I heard about him. It seems he did pretty well.
Yeah, he did. He did really well. I think he got I think he made top 8 losers. And I think he played, did he play Sonic Fox first?
Yes, he did.
Yeah, he played him in the Cassie Mirror.
Yeah, which is 6-4 Cassie. That's weird.
But the entire matchup was just like each character just punishing back 1-2 all day.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's -6 on block and it's got a gap in it. So it's like a guaranteed punish, really.
Yeah, like you can't really... I mean, I know me and Gabe were testing that after that, and I think like the only option really, if you read that they are going to try and punish you, is to do an EX flip kick. But if they read you're going to do that and they just block, it's like you just wasted a bar for nothing. It's like, it's kind of silly, that guessing game in the Casimiro. It's like, it's really...
Oh, I can imagine.
It's just really stupid. It's like, okay, well... Yeah, like, I don't know. That is a very weird match. Like, I think that's kind of a, like, side effect of Cassie. Like, her having, like, the only 6-frame reversal now in the game. It's like, there's a lot of stuff that it's like, oh yeah, Cassie can punish that, but nobody else can. Like, it's weird. She's a strange character in that regard.
I think the coolest thing I saw from the Grand Finals was the Goro was pretty interesting to see from Forever King. But, I still think DJT's 49% meterless Grandmaster Corner combo is the sickest thing I've seen.
Yeah, DJT's Sub-Zero looks super on point.
Like, when he switched over to Sub-Zero, he won that first match fast.
Super fast.
It was over in a heartbeat. Though.
I mean,
As soon as he went Sub-Zero, he just fucking went in on Predator like a 10-ton truck. He made Predator look like he hits like a faggot.
I think because in that matchup, like, the Predator is all kinds of good, but the one thing Predator is slow. Sub-Zero is not slow. Like, you need to be able to keep up with Sub-Zero, you know? Like, if you can't keep up with Sub-Zero, you are in trouble. Mm-hmm. And I think, like, I mean, early on at least, like, I don't know if they've really grinded that matchup, they may have, who knows. But that was the one thing that stood out immediately when he went to Sub-Zero. It's like, wow, Predator just cannot... It seemingly, like, just cannot get anything started because Sub-Zero is just so fast. So, that was something that was, like, really apparent in the matchup. But it was hype to see Goro. You know, of course, now this means Goro's top 5. All this bullshit. But it was really cool to see Goro, like, in tournament because you just never see him. And, like, I think Goro is really hyped to watch as well. Like, just watch, like, his combos are really cool. Like, the way his combos work. Like, he's just a hype character. It's cool to see Goro. But what did you guys think of Pools? Like, because top 8 was really good. I really did enjoy top 8, but...
Pools was a ball fest, let's be serious.
Yeah, Pools, like, I mean, it felt like one of those tournaments where if you were there, you can go and, you know, watch the good matches, which is all good, but stream-wise, I don't think DMS was at this tournament, because if he was, I imagine he would have been, like, sorting stuff out as far as the stream goes, because the stream matches were pretty boring. And don't really mean that as a knock on the players. It's whatever, but they weren't really that hype on the stream.
A lot of them were one-sided as well. Yeah, well, obviously due to the bars of Yomi.
Yeah, a lot of them were just kind of people getting blown up. Nothing personal, but a lot of people were just kind of getting blown up on stream. Mm-hmm. I think the commentary was good. But I think Katana Prime is one of, if not probably the best commentator in the NRS scene at the moment. He, I always enjoy his commentary.
He is, and, man. He's really entertaining, I think.
Yeah.
He also really looks like Hollow.
But he knows his shit as well.
Hollow and Katana Prime look the same.
I've never actually heard Hollow commentate.
But you said they look the same.
Oh, they look the same. Yeah. They do. They look similar, I guess. I'd say the same.
You ever seen Hollow's brother?
Katana
looks
Prime's
just
got,
like him.
Katana Prime's got way better hair.
Yeah, look at Hollow's brother if you ever get the chance. He's just, I've met him once, and I swear to God, I thought he was Katana Prime at first.
I've never seen him, so...
He literally has exactly the same hairstyle, same facial hair and everything. Like, it's really scary.
Okay.
Well, I mean, Hollow's quit the game, so the odds of seeing his brother is, like, pretty slim, but yeah.
His brother plays Smash.
Oh, okay, yeah, I don't play Smash, so...
Yeah,
it's just his two boys, you never know.
yeah, you never know.
Yeah, Black Adam version 2. Black I was Adam. So sick of that Black Adam during Injustice. I was so sick of it. I used to go down to the Meltdown weeklies. Like, I would just make, like, finals over there and then just get destroyed by the Black Adam just because dive kick. I was like,
who
I
did
don't
you play?
Do. I played Nightwing.
Was it still Nightwing? Yeah.
I played Nightwing the entire Injustice life I had because Nightwing's, like, Nightwing's bae.
Nightwing is cool in Injustice.
Yeah, I just play characters who I like, and I just like Nightwing from comics, so I was like, I'm just going to play Nightwing.
Explain Tanya.
Yeah, now I switched the Kobujutsu to Tanya because it just felt like Nightwing in a bit, and she looks like me, so I'm alright.
Oh, yeah.
Smiling, these are some pretty thin excuses right here.
this is why I was like, I just want a stupid character that can actually, like, do stuff, because Kenshi just felt garbage, so I was like, I'm just gonna play Katana. No, I was gonna play, like, Lao or something, and I was like, wait, no, I'm not. I'm like, Tanya kind of looks like me. I was like, I'll just play Tanya for now, and then she was like, good, and I was like, oh, cool.
So Lao's not good enough. Tanya.
No, Lao's too much work. Tanya, I can just press buttons.
Fair enough.
the secret behind my gameplay.
Yeah. But, any pools matches from TFC you guys can remember that are actually really good?
I think the only one that's memorable is, what's his name? I think the name was Deuce Tier, one of the players. Essentially, it was the Kung Lao Jax match.
Although, that was Tier Problems. I think the Kung Lao's name was Tier Problems, yeah.
Yeah, mainly because the commentary is what made it quite entertaining.
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
But to be fair, most of the entertaining matches happened from like top 32 onwards.
Yeah, top 32 onwards was really good. But yeah, I think pools were a bit like, not necessarily like, because there was some good players, but it just seemed like every match was, from what I recall at least, was fairly one-sided. You didn't really get many kind of like down to the wire moments. It was, you know, someone would just kind of get blown up and then that was it, unfortunately. Or land like 2,000 EX spins in one round.
I think a lot of the time during pools, it was just like, this time I was just going to Tesla Mike just to get the updates. I weren't really interested in the matches because you kind of knew what way they were going.
Yeah, that's true. I did get, it sounds harsher than it is, but I did get kind of bored a few times, like in pools. It was like, there's just not really, just not really any good matches on, unfortunately. But those, like, top 32 ones were really good. I really enjoyed Blake's matches. Him and Katana Prime, I think, was probably my favourite match of the tournament, to be fair. Mm-hmm. That was a really, really good match. I love that match. I think Saltface had some good matches, too. Saltface had some really good ones. Who else was there? There was someone else I feel like I'm forgetting.
Blake and Chris G, like, first match.
Oh, yeah, Chris G. Yeah, Chris G. Chris G is always entertaining to watch, really, just because... Like, if he wins, you know, it's funny. If he loses, it's, I don't play this game. Like, you know.
Essentially, yeah.
Yeah. He's always entertaining for the stream.
Yo, well, I'll tell you this, though. He wasn't doing bad against Sonic Fox. He's done his homework with Deceptive.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I mean, he plays... Yeah, I mean, he does play Reptile, doesn't he? So, he plays Reptile and Kung Jin are the ones I've seen him play the most. He did have a Hellfire Scorpion back when everybody thought he was broken. But, like, that wasn't much to shout about.
Turned out to be a sack of shit.
Yeah, a lot of people, to be fair, a lot of people, you know, were quick to be like, oh, he's top 5? Okay, I'll try him out. It's like, nah.
There's obviously no venom in that statement at all.
There's not. Well, there is obviously them. I've got plenty of venom. But it was true. You saw a fair amount. Like Glass Sword used him. Waffles used him. And did you guys see? I think that was a mirror match at a GBS.
No.
I highly recommend watching that match. It's entertaining. for lack of a better word. But yes, I think like Reptile and Shaolin, I think it's Shaolin Kungjin, isn't it, or his business. So although he does use Bojutsu every now and then. I think he actually used Bojutsu in his first match in pools, if I remember rightly.
You don't know who I've seen who has a really good Shaolin, but he doesn't give himself enough credit for.
Who?
It's Smokey.
Not seen him play, to be honest.
He's a player from Norwich. He plays a lot with Carnage.
Yeah, he was at
the London qualifier. He plays Johnny.
He was at Keep It Classy, actually. He was playing Shaolin there in casuals. Weren't too bad at all, man.
It's actually really good. He just doesn't give himself enough credit for it. But he's picked up D'Vorah and now he's dropped Cage.
What variation of D'Vorah is he playing?
Swarm Queen.
Okay.
His execution's fairly good, so I'm sure I haven't played it yet, though.
Why did he drop Cage?
I don't know, I just got frustrated with it.
I think something happened to the Mimics in Stunt Double. Because, even though he's got good execution, he can't play A-list. Like, Stunt Double was always, his bread and butter. But apparently they did something to the Mimic startup, or the 2-in-1 ability, or something like that. And I think that just kind of picked him right, and he thought, sod it, I'm moving on.
Fair enough.
What else was there about TFC? I feel like there was something I'm forgetting to talk about. It was a match, but I really can't remember what it was.
Was it in top 8 or was it top 8?
No, I think it was top 16, but I can't remember the players.
Maybe it was top 8. Are you not thinking of Slayer and Sonic 4?
That was a good match, but no, that's not
what
I'm thinking of.
That was a Robots match.
Was it involving Sonic Fox in any manner?
No, it wasn't. I'll think about it. It might come to me. So,
okay.
Any other matches you guys want to touch on for TFC?
I kind of feel MIT could have beaten Sonic Fox.
Yeah.
With Sanya. But it wasn't meant to be. There was a moment, though. I think it might have been for the match where MIT had about 30% health with a 4 meter, and Sonic Fox was full screen away, 4 meter, but about 20% health. And all Sonic Fox was doing was throwing fans. And I was saying to myself, MRT basically just needs to stay away, just avoid the fans, because obviously they're high, just neutral dark. If you EX, then duck the first one, jump the second one, and make Sonic Fox come to you, because there's still like close to about 30 seconds left. Mm-hmm. But MRT kept forcing the issue of trying to come in. And he essentially lost that round eventually once he got towards Sonic Fox. But I just thought, why did he do that? You had the life lead. I would assume that Sonya is just as good, if not better, up close than Kitana is. So he could have waited and let Sonic Fox come to him and then see what happens from there. But anyway.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know, like, MIT's, like, it's always strange when MIT ventures away from Tanya, because it seems like Tanya really is, like, his business, but...
Yeah, I spoke to him on Twitter, and he was, like, another positive reinforcement I had towards playing her.
Yeah. But I remember the player, I can't remember the match, though. It was the, I think he had Blue in his name, and he was a Kano player. Did any of you guys see his matches?
What variation did he use?
Yeah, what variation?
Mainly Commando, which is why it was fucking hype. But yeah, mainly Commando. I can't remember who was playing. He had a good match against Zyfox first, but then Zyfox went to... Because Zyfox originally went to Kado and got bodied, and then went to Flame Fist.
I remember that match, yeah.
Yeah, but he just had a really good Kano. Like, it was really good to see a Commando Kano kind of wrecking people. Like, he did really well, and I'm just trying to remember the other player he fought. So he had really close matches. He was, like, one of the few kind of highlights in pools, was seeing his Commando, like, bot people. It was really cool. So, anything else from TFC, guys, or do you want to move on?
I did like a Quiet Store, actually, as well. He was a Ravenous Molina.
Oh, yeah.
And he actually was quite on point in his performances. Just needs to get a bit more damage on his combos. But aside from that, I thought he was actually quite solid.
Yeah. Cool. Strykie, Falkunn, anything else?
Go on, Falkunn.
Nah, I got nothing.
Okay.
Yeah, I would just point out Slayer and Sonic Fox. I mean, everyone watching it knows how good the match was. I think the conversions that Slayer was just pulling off were just out of this world, man. And like, yeah, he's not even the Kung Lao main. And it's like, they're 10 times better than my conversion to Scorpion. It's like, shit, man, I've got to sort my shit out.
Yeah, some of his conversions were really good. I really loved it when like you get a poke as an anti-air, but like, and then just do like instant air dive kick and take that into like a regular B&B.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that looked really sick. Kung Lao does look cool, like when he does combos and stuff, even though he is kind of annoying, but his combos do look cool. So.
They always do.
Yeah. So moving on, guys. Let's move on to some of the aftermath of this patch. We did touch on Venomous getting some good buffs, and let's talk about Venomous D'Vorah for a few minutes. What do you guys think about her? Like, now that you've had like a bit of time to either, you know, like look into her or play against one or anything like that. I know I've played Gabe quite a bit with mine, so I'll start with Gabe. Like, what do you think about her now that, like, you know, people have had like a time, like I've had time to kind of really get to grips with her post patch and like really kind of take advantage of all of her buffs. What do you think about the variation now?
Well, I remember when we recorded after the patch, I did say that Venomous D'Vorah was going to be another monster that they've created, and I believe that prophecy has come to fruition. Put it in layman's terms, she's a bit stupid, but I guess it's just more bullshit on top of the other bullshit that's already in this game. So, in that sense, she's fine.
There's bigger fish, you might say.
Yeah, essentially.
Yeah.
I think what obviously pisses people off is the two ticks and almost everything. With her already amazing footsies and almost everything converting into water pistol, as you call it, which is now not interruptible.
Off of certain strings. Off certain strings. Off the top of my head, it's forward 112, forward 11, forward 44. And I think that's it. The rest, like all of her other strings, jail into EX bug spray because it's a lot faster now. But like, it's the strings that jail into regular bug spray. It's like, oh, and forward 22. How could I forget forward 22? Yeah, like, and I think it's the forward 22 jailing into it that's a bit like, oh, this is a bit annoying. But yeah, like that's kind of the thing. And the increased speed on it also means that like restands are now possible from like. Virtually any away. Conversion. Yeah. Like, yeah. So, yeah, there's that as well. But, yeah, carry on.
And is that, obviously, she's got, like, a 50-50 with back one and 4-2-2. So if you guess wrong, you're eating for water pistol. And I think it's also the fact that you don't really have to work hard. You literally are just a couple of strings into water pistol and maybe a throw. And then you've lost like about 30-40% already.
I'm working overtime. Doing anything. How dare you discredit my character? I kind of agree. I know we were playing the other day, actually. It was a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
And I remember I said to you like that the annoying thing about playing Venomous is you don't really get to do combos. Like you because like she punishes so hard that like you know people are kind of like almost a bit wooden around playing her. They're like, okay. I don't want to do anything that's punishable, so let's just see what she does, and then all of a sudden, I'm coming in and you've been thrown. It's like, okay, well, that's like 13%. I'm going to get up. She's coming in again. Okay, maybe a throw. Oh, God, I got hit by forward 2-2. That's like another 20%. So you're always thinking to yourself, like, you know, I just can't whiff or do anything that she can full combo, because then I'm really in trouble. But all the while you're thinking about that, she's just chipping away at you. She's just taking little bits of health here and there, and before you know it, you can lose like 60%, and you think, wait, I haven't been comboed yet, but I'm almost dead.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very weird design, the way she works now is kind of weird. But I think the biggest thing, like playing the variation, I know Foss is, I don't know if he's put time into it, but it definitely feels like he has. He's a lot better now at punishing bug spray. And that's kind of like that's, I think, rule number one against that matchup is, like, if you... Granted, I'm not saying it's easy to punish Bug Spray. It's not. It is hard. But at the end of the day, if something's full combo punishable, it's full combo punishable. And that's something you need to work on. You know?
True.
Like is Cage's EX Nut Punch in A-list easy to punish if you block it crouching? No. But is it punishable? Yes. Like, so... You know, and that's kind of an important thing in the matchup. You know, if someone shows you that they never ever punish Bug Spray, then that's, you know, that's awful, because then that's kind of just a free pass for the D'Vorah player to just do it over and over and over again until you punish it. If I do that and the very first time you block it you full combo it for like 40%, I'm gonna think twice about doing it at the end of a string, mm-hmm. because I don't want to lose 40%. So that's kind of what I feel about it. I think there's a lot of stuff being thrown around about her that is... It's just untrue. The video I posted, that combo, that was, as I said, it was kind of a joke. It was like, ah, look how stupid this is. And immediately, like, oh, she does 50% no bar, like, was being thrown around. It's like, yeah, that's not true. Come on. Like, that's, you know, let's be serious and just actually look at the character. So, but Strykie, Falkunn, what do you think about her since the buffs? Have you guys, like, played any Venomous players or, like, looked into her more yourselves?
I haven't really played your Venomous since before the patch, have I?
I don't think so, no. Because I know when you're online, I know you don't play online much. So, and Venomous online is kind of silly. So,
yeah, that's kind of the thing. I think that's what's rustling people's jimmies. Because one time earlier this week, I did go online, and I was like, "Fuck it, no one's on. Let's go into ranked." And it was just like, Venomous D'Vorah after Venomous D'Vorah after Venomous D'Vorah, and they all had the same game plan. It was like 4-2-2 Bug Spray, rinse and repeat. And then by the time I got to the corner, it was just like machine gun down one. It's like, what the hell is going on, man?
Yeah,
down one, I mean, massive boys.
Like 4-2-2 into Bug Spray, like 4-2-2 into Bug Spray into another 4-2-2. Like that's stupid. That's not a thing at all. Like, the Bug Spray's, like, regular Bug Spray's minus 13, forward to 17 frames. That's 30 frames. Like, that's not a thing. You know, you should be doing something about that, for sure. And I think that's where, like, the fear is coming from. It's like, you know, people don't really realize that Bug Spray is actually really bad on block. And it is kind of it is unusual the way it works, because a lot of, like, in MKX, like, most of the moves, they have their blocks done at a certain point during the animation. That's when you recover. Bug Spray is one of the few that's like, okay, you blocked it, punish it. And it's like, if you're a split second late, too bad. Like, you know, their recovery's gone and you won't get a punish. And I think because it's one of the few moves that does work that way in the game, you know, people have a hard time punishing it, you know. I mean, it's not easy to punish, like, don't get me wrong. Like, unless you have a reversal, doing a string or something to punish it is not easy. It's something you really are going to have to practice. So, but I mean, I haven't fought one yet, so...
Yeah, for the most part, I would just, like, worst case scenario, set for reversal takedown, but I was even watching that because I was just so mesmerized by how much blocks then there was and how much venom was adding up. I think that's the problem. Like, people are more trivialized by the new buffs more than how good they are in the long run. Like, yeah. It could just be a prisoner of the moment reaction. We need more time to get comfortable with it.
Yeah, I agree. She's definitely the flavor of the month right now. You know, Venomous is, like, definitely being pumped up a lot.
You're going to make an amazing Jax pun right there, but you didn't.
No.
Well, Venomous D'Vorah, I mean...
Yeah. yeah, like, have you played her or, like, looked into her? Like,
you were saying pumped up, so I was like, I was hoping for a Jax pun, but you didn't. Ugh.
No, I would have made one if I had one to hand.
well, Venomous D'Vorah is continue.
I was going to say, yeah, let's continue talking about these swarm of D'Vorahs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's silly.
Okay.
That's what it is.
Give me props.
No,
that pun was
dead. You don't deserve props for that.
Yeah, that
sorry.
Was bad. Yeah, you might need to go brood over that one. That wasn't very good.
You literally baited yourself. But effectively, I mean, like, Venomous D'Vorah is obviously really good. I didn't get a chance to watch that video, though.
It was just a combo I did online. And that's the other thing. Like, I did make a follow-up video to explain how Venom stacking works, because, I mean, of course that information's out there, but it's not in a video, so it basically doesn't exist. So I made a video to go over that, and I mentioned in that video, like, you know, the combo video I post, like, me and Foss, like, we were playing at, like, I think it was about 1:30 in the morning. We'd already been playing for hours, like, we were just kind of having a bit of fun. It's like, yeah, it was an online combo. It started from a jumping punch, so it's not a combo. But yeah, you know, it just kind of, you know, evolved into like, oh my god, this is ridiculous. She's broken. She does Half-Life for no bar. It's like, whoa, like, hold on a minute. Like, you know, let's just slow it down. That's kind of what happened with the video. So I blame myself. It's my fault. But yeah, carry on.
I mean, like, well, Venomous is obviously good. I have been kind of out of the loop. I haven't been on TYM as much because I've been pretty busy with some other stuff. But I haven't actually played any Venomous D'Vorahs since the patch. Mm-hmm. And even then, like, just sort of reading the patch notes, I can already sense that she's a pretty big threat at the moment.
She is if you don't, like, know her. For sure. Like,
yeah, but
I think that's what's like blowing people up at the moment. I think it was a lesser variation, so people didn't.
That's
bother
true.
Looking into
I mean, the only Venomous yeah. experience I have is against ODI and when Jake played Venomous. Mm-hmm. So like early MKX days when Musser was playing Venomous D'Vorah. I mean, that's kind of all I had. But there's nothing within the current patch of D'Vorah that I have played. It's just what I've read, and it seems to be pretty decent. So I'm glad that they have buffed it. Because I felt like D'Vorah did need it. Well, Venomous in particular. I don't actually think that... I think, like, D'Vorah has amazing normals and stuff like that. But in terms of character, she just felt a bit... eh, I guess. Like, she was good, but she didn't really feel like, you know, like, godlike, like what Tempest Lao felt like at the time and stuff like that.
To be fair, that's when Tempest Lao was basically fucking broken.
Like, yeah.
Wasn't that when, like, he had, like, plus 27 EX hat? Like...
You know when they changed that? Like, so it was, like, what, plus 12 or something like that?
They put it, like, down to plus 12, like, from plus 27.
Yeah, I just feel like she just sort of needed something like that, you know, something that really gave her some kind of advantage.
She's got that in Swarm Queen.
Yeah, that's true. I just felt like Venomous really needed something. It's quite slept on.
I don't know if it needed something. I just don't think it needed everything, because I did actually pick up... When I first started playing D'Vorah, I picked up Venomous, because I love, like, damage over time. I just think that's a really cool mechanic, so if a character has that, I'll usually pick them up. And before the patches, I think someone... I can't remember their name, but they mentioned it on TYM, that, like, one buff they would give to Venomous was make her stinger attacks do venom damage, which are basically, like, the things that come out of her hand. Mm. And that is a buff that she got. And... personally, I think that's all she really needed, because before that, her damage was just terrible in Venomous. Like, if you got like a standing one punish, you know, like, which is 8 frames, then unless you wanted to spend bar, you'd get like maybe 22% with a restand. You could do like 25, 27, but then you'd like knock them away from you. So like her damage was definitely, you know, kind of hampered by that. Giving her Venom on the stingers fixed that problem, but they also sped up bug spray, which now gave her like, which is kind of the snowball effect. They sped up bug spray, so it gave her strings that jailed into bug spray. It gave her new restand combos because bug spray's faster, and they gave her venom on ticks on the stinger moves. It's like, you know, the first one, yeah, this, like, any two of those, fair enough, but all three, it's like, whoa, okay, you might have given her a bit too much. You might have, like, I don't know. Like, I don't know yet, but...
I feel like I'm just glad that NetherRealm really buffed the variations that were kind of slept on.
Mm. I mean, like... I think that's kind of the problem of buffing variations that are slept on. Because, you know, like, people... when they say, oh, what variations are bad, people will just rattle off variations that they don't know anything about.
Yeah, I mean, like, I honestly don't... I feel like there might be, like... I don't think anything in the game is actually bad. I just feel like some are just not as good as others. That's it.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
but none of them are actually, like, bad. Like, Spectral Ermac before the patch, I thought was just garbage. Like, easily the worst thing in the game. But even I haven't actually seen any spectral players now at all, but I imagine he isn't as bad now. He's kind of doable to some standard. He's probably still bad though. I don't know. But maybe. Ronin Takeda is ridiculous.
He's ridiculous now, but I mean, yeah. Like Phosphorax played Ronin. Let's talk about Ronin, actually. He's our next topic anyway, so yeah. But let's move on to Ronin Takeda. Phosphorax started playing Ronin not long before the patch, probably a few weeks, and I played a few games, like, started playing him regularly against Ronin. And he had a really good Ronin. Like, made the character look really good. Now he can, you know, the term, phrase of the month is pseudo-block infinite people with his new plus frames. Which, of course, is fine, because that means you managed your meter poorly, and you deserve to lose your entire life to a block string. Which, I wish I was making that up. That was actually said.
On who said that?
What's his name? Something, like, something to do with Pepper or something? I don't remember his tag.
Prof Dr. Pepper or something like that.
That, yeah. That
I know
right.
He was.
Wait, yeah. Wasn't he a Kenshi player?
Sounds about
he
right.
He is, yeah. Right.
Yeah.
But yeah, like basically, like the paper thin arguments for defending, you know, a block infinite. It's like, come on, guys, like, no. But are you guys familiar with it? Like, what the string is, what it does?
Nope.
I right. don't. You have to fill me in.
Okay, it's in. You know how in Ronin he can lay down his lightsabers and then call them back to him.
The blade callback.
Yeah, blade call, and I don't know what the blade like lay down is called. But like where he just puts
blade them, drop.
Blade drop, that's it, yeah. He does back 2-1, 2+4, which I think that's the right notation. It's his like overhead low like, you know, starter in Ronin.
Yeah, I know the string.
Yeah, and then he does that into blade drop, and then he does forward 1-2, 2+4, into blade callback, which leaves him people are saying +10. It's one thing I keep meaning to actually work out the frames and like work out what jails, but people are saying like it's at least +10. So, you know, that I think jails into back 2. I'm going to have to double check the frames on his back 2, but that's basically the string. Back 2, 1, 2 plus 4, put the blade down, and then forward 1, 2, 2 plus 4, call it back to yourself. And if you don't have, I think, a 7 or 8 frame normal, it block infinites you. Like, you cannot get out of that if you don't have a normal quicker than that. You need to, like, you can armor it, but, you know, if you don't have any meat, you're dead, basically. You have to get hit. Take the hit, bro. Like that argument.
Yeah, we're all too familiar with that argument, aren't we, Jay?
Yeah, we were. Like, to be honest, like that was a huge blow up when that was getting thrown around, even by Scorpions. It's like, take the hit, bro. It's like, that's stupid. Like, if your only way out is to get hit, like, dude, that's not good. It's dumb. But yeah, like stuff like that. Like after this patch, I mean, like. It's a new thing as well, you know, like Liu Kang still has his forward 2-3 run cancel pressure. That's like, he can still jail that in Dragon's Fire. Now, you know, like Takeda's kind of got a new one, you know, like we had Aelis Cage and we had D'Vorah and we had Liu Kang. Now we've also got to throw Takeda in that mix.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you guys think? Like just tone down the plus frames, make it like +5 or something. So like nothing's guaranteed. Like,
well,
what do you think?
You're saying it's, after the blade callback, he can jail into back 2, right?
If you don't have an 8 frame or faster normal, I think. I'll double check the thread, but yeah. That's,
but it is back 2.
I'm pretty sure it's back 2. Yeah, that's the overhead starter in Ronin.
Yeah. Sure, to my understanding, that normal was a lot slower pre-patch, right?
I believe so, yeah. I think it did get sped up.
Mm. I do think there needs to be a regulation, but I think they should at least like keep the utility of the buffs in the back too, because I remember when the whole Raiden blocking from the debacle was going about with his forward 1-2, when his forward 1 used to be mid.
Yeah.
A lot of people were advocating to say to make forward 1-2 -5, but NRS kind of copped out and just made the forward 1 a high. Like, I don't play Raiden. I don't particularly enjoy fighting Raiden, but even I have to admit, I think that was a lazy nerf, so I think it'd be a shame either way to see it happen to Kano, you know?
Yeah, I think the Raiden thing, though, like, because that is interesting, how Raiden kind of has fallen off pretty significantly. And, like, I think it was just back then, in the context of the entire game, to have a 6-frame mid that led to what that led to, like, regardless of the infinite stuff, but, like, just damage-wise, I think it was just a bit ridiculous that he had that. Like, maybe making it high in the long run was too much, but I think, like, a six-frame mid is pretty stupid in this game. Like, I mean, how many characters have even a six-frame high? Like, not many. To have a six-frame mid was a bit like, whoa, shit. This is kind of silly. So, but yeah, I agree, though. I think they should just tone down the advantage. It's like, it's good utility. Like, it just, you know, there's no way you should just be block infinite, like, you know, for in any situation. Like, I don't think there's any, like, justification for, like, okay, you did this, now you die, no matter what. Like, that's stupid. Like, I don't think you could ever justify a block infinite, in my opinion. So, what are your thoughts on it, Gabe?
Well, if you block infinites even at one member of the cast, then it kind of needs to be toned down, because at the end of the day, a block infinite is a block infinite. They really shouldn't have any place in the fighting game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's fairly straightforward. The people that are defending it, it's like,
I can guess people are defending due to the amount of crazy stuff that other characters do have. This is the one thing. Yeah, I don't know how to block
it. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, sorry, I'm just saying, like, block infinite. Like, yeah. It's like, come on.
Mm-hmm. So the currency is like, this is their BS that they have to compete with others, so it should be fine if others can have whatever BS that they've got. Mm-hmm. It's not the right attitude to have, but I can understand why people have it.
Yeah, I agree. Falkunn, have you looked into Takeda since the patch?
I have. I haven't really done excessive research because I've been so busy, but it's weird. Like, I agree with Gabe in the sense that no one should have a block infinite against, like, anyone in the cast, because that's stupid. I just feel like maybe if they just sort of normalized it a bit and just... how do I describe this? Like, he's good. I like the fact that he's good. I just don't want him to be broken against anyone in any sense, because it's stupid. Like, I feel like everything they have given him, aside from, you know, like, ridiculous frame invention, certain things, or certain setups, well, you know, certain things you can do on block, I feel like everything else is good, though. Like, because I used to play Zigzag when I was on Xbox One, and that was only temporarily. He was using Ronin far before the patch, and he was actually giving me some trouble with it. Like, he was playing it pretty well, and I think he's been trying it ever since the patch, and he seems pretty content with it. And, like,
I imagine he is.
Pretty much. Like, because I think there's this thing he was telling me about where it's like, it's back to 1, 2 plus 4 into the sword toss, and then EX to lift them back up, and then forward 1, 2 into the 2 plus 4 for the lash thing. Mm-hmm. So that comes out, and then you throw down another sword, and then you just go for just like a block string, and you have the threat of, like, lifting it back up, or you can do something else, or I'm not sure. But it seems pretty decent.
Yeah, I'm not too familiar with, like, his mid-string hit levels. So, because when he does drop the blade, he does lose back 2, because, like, he hasn't got it.
Yeah. I mean, like, then again, like, back 3 is a pretty decent advancing normal in that sense.
Yeah, the guy who posted it, he did actually mention that in the thread when he posted, like, the stuff. He said that, you know, some characters can, like, backdash or something, but he then goes on to say, but, like, you can just use back 3, like, back 3 or forward 3 to, like, chase it down. And it's like, yeah, so, you know, you can backdash, but then if he does do that, you're not even going to have stamina to break immediately. So,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the characters he does infinite, he has put them in the post. It's Jason, Kenshi, Kitana, Takeda, ironically, and Aaron Black.
God bless that I dropped Kenshi.
Is that, does Takeda block it infinite himself in every variation?
In fact, his normals. Yeah.
Okay, it depends on his normals, right?
Yeah, it does, but I don't think his actual pokes are affected by...
The late 9 frames is the
his
fastest.
Variations, yeah, and his pokes are faster than his normals, so, yeah. Like, poor Takeda.
Takeda mirrors the new fear.
Yeah, we need to see a Takeda mirror. So, anything else you guys want to touch on of that, or like anything to do with the patch in general, really? Like, since we've had a bit of time to kind of dig into it a bit more.
Yeah, I'm sad that they nerfed Tanya's bug. The two hits of armor. Yeah, not the throw. The two hits of armor. The two hits of armor.
That was so stupid.
It was so funny. It's like, I remember playing online against this guy in like online ranked. I got really bored one night and I was like, whatever, I'm just going to play some online ranked and see what happens. And I played this guy and I got him with just back one down two, just knock him down. And then I was like, okay, he's been EX wake upping like all the time. So I'm just going to go back two. It's really punishable though, but it's like, you know, double high into the overhead. So if he does anything, it'll just snuff out the armor. He didn't end up doing it. He ended up just blocking on wake up, and then he tried to punish me with he tried to punish me with a double hitting attack, but I can't remember who he was playing now, and I just armored straight through it. I think it was Melina's EX roll. Mm-hmm. And he did that, and I just armored like both hits of it because I did it slow enough, and then he just like sent me rage mail, and I was like, this is glorious. I hope this stays forever. But I thought it was canon when I first heard about it before I played Tanya. I thought she just had two hits of armor on her EX Taunt for Strike. But then I was like, they said it was a bug, and I was like, yeah, that sounds about right then. That's pretty broken.
Everything's a bug, isn't it? Everything's a bug.
I called bollocks on that one. They've had two major patches to address that, and they've only just fixed it.
Yeah, that's why I thought it was canon.
Yeah.
There's a lot of bugs in this game. There's a lot of bugs.
Yeah, no doubt.
Like if D'Vorah gets her venom stuff, it's like, fixed a bug where her...
All right, that's just too punny.
Yeah, it's like, fixed a bug with Venomous. Nah, it'd be better if it was Broodmother. Like, fixed a bug with
Fixed a bug where she had no hair.
Dude, we talk about that costume. How bad that costume is.
It's so atrocious.
Yeah, that costume bugs me. That wasn't intentional. Dude,
that was bad.
That was worse than the first one.
Right, hear me out, right? That second one was not intentional.
Fair enough.
Wasn't working as intended. Okay, fair enough.
But I can't, that's one of the reasons I just can't play Broodmother. Like, she needs the HUD up. Like D'Vorah needs to have the HUD up. Otherwise, it's just...
Either that or just give her, like, a 70s hairstyle. Like, you play the mystery game, what does she have under the hood? And then every time you choose her, it's, like, a different hairstyle. Be great. You imagine if, like, she just had, like, a different headpiece or something like that. What if she, like, took off the hood one day, or it fell off during combat and she had, like, Kotal Kahn's headpiece? That'd be great.
I don't know, the headpiece is probably bigger than her.
Exactly. So. Yeah. It'd be like the whole Scooby-Doo effect when you pull off the mask and their face is bigger than the mask.
Yeah. It'd be like a... Do you guys remember Ed and Eddie?
I do remember
the Jawbreaker effect.
Do you remember, like, we never got to see what was under Double D's hat?
Maybe yeah, that's D'Vorah. Double D is D'Vorah.
Maybe.
That's my new handle now. I'm going to be called Double D'Vorah, and I'm just going to main her.
Double D'Vorah.
Always going to come in wearing a beanie and have something new under the beanie every single tournament.
I can dig that.
Moving on. Let's move on. More topics, guys. This one could be juicy, depending on who you guys have got for it. Players who have failed to deliver in MKX so far, and will they in the future?
Perfect Legend.
Damn. Okay, that was kind of an easy... That was an easy first one. But yeah, I mean, we could definitely use
By no means is, like, PL a bad player, but, you know...
He's certainly
achieved much more than I have, so I can't exactly trash talk, but, you know, like, I don't think he's really... achieved that much in this game.
He hasn't even really done bad. He hasn't. Like, I mean, he did well in ESL.
Yeah,
I think
that's
it's
true.
Because of I think it's because of like how he kind of pumps himself up and like the you know the kind of opinion.
I just
he has
feel like
himself.
The one thing is he should not have trash talked Sonic Fox.
That was stupid.
that was pretty bad. But I'm not gonna give him shit for it.
Though.
I'm not gonna give him shit for it. Like, there's no point. He's achieved much more than I have. But it's just, you know, you kind of have to put your money where your mouth is. It's like, I think there was a similar effect with, like, CD Jr., wasn't there?
Where... Yeah, he was going to be my pick for this, actually.
He was going to be my pick as well.
Damn, okay.
I bet you guys.
I think somebody else now, tough. But yeah, he was going to be my pick, because he's definitely a good player, but, like, just not really doing much in this game. Like, doing, you know, he's in every stream chat, like, you know, passively, aggressively, like, trashing the game. And it's like, well, you know, you're talking a lot about a game that you don't really know much about. So, you know, a little less talk, a little more play would like do well in your favor. And I think like PL and Sonic Fox, like, I respect him for challenging him. The Aaron Black like secondary challenge was
Sonic Fox basically 13-0'd him in the first of 10.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, if he'd have just kind of accepted that, then fine, because like, I still say not many people would have sat through that. Plenty of other people probably would have just got up and walked off at like 7 or 8-0.
Like, yeah, I mean, you know,
at least
fairness,
he did stay for the whole thing.
That's true. He didn't just bail out. Like he stuck to his word, which is always respectable.
Yeah.
But it's kind of like you did trash talk him, you did lose, but you know, at least you stuck through it all. That's what counts.
Yeah, he did. Because I mean, there are plenty of people that wouldn't. So, Gabe, what's your pick for this? While Strykie hopefully thinks of someone else.
This might be seen as quite harsh.
All right.
But
Juicy? Okay, let's do this.
I kind of think both Brady and Rio have been under-delivering so far.
Interesting.
And what I sense is, not necessarily them maybe, but there was a lot of talk, a lot of hype that when MK come out, they're going to be the guys to come back and literally take all the tournaments by storm, etc., etc.
I was kind of expecting, like, you know, like how they were in MK9.
Yeah, that kind of fear. Now, with Rio, I mean, he's the kind of guy that needs to find his character first. And it's probably taking quite a bit longer than maybe most people have expected. I mean, he's still doing quite well, but I don't think he's probably doing as well as everyone expected him to be doing.
Yeah, but then again, there's so much new competition as well.
Yeah, that's another thing. And as for Brady, being Mr. Sub-Zero, I do want him to actually come back to the point of him getting regular top 8s, because I always like watching Brady. Super hype and super fun to watch.
So do I.
But so far, it's just not working for him.
Look at that.
Brady is the hype, man. Like, yeah. When Brady is around, it's so different. Like, when you're at a tournament and when you're watching a stream, like, I mean, when you're watching a stream, you know, when Brady arrives, like, commentators immediately say it, don't they? It's like, Brady just walked in. Damn!
Exactly. You
know? It's so good.
It's so great.
Treat him like Vince McMahon.
Yeah, that's actually a good analogy. But yeah, like, he really does bring the hype, and when he plays, like, I kind of agree, that's a good two picks. I think Rio's still done very well, but, you know, definitely going by MK9 standards, it's definitely not the same. I mean, he's still got, like, you know, plenty of top 8s. He did really well in ESL.
Uh-huh.
But, yeah, in terms of, like, his MK9 kind of performance, then, like, 100%, yeah, he's definitely not where he was.
Does Maxter play MKX?
He does, and the one tournament I think he's been to, he got top 8.
That's good, then.
Which was TFC, actually, I think.
Because I did enjoy watching him in MK9.
Yeah, wait, the TFC just gone?
I can't remember. It was either TFC or Summer Jam. I think it was Summer Jam.
He wasn't in Top 8 for Summer Jam. Top 8 was Michelangelo.
It must have been TFC.
It must have been TFC, because I didn't see TFC's Top 8.
Or it might have been Top 16. I'll quickly double check.
It could have been Summer Jam Top 16, because I only caught Top 8.
Yeah, I'll just check now. Strykie, who's your pick? Or do you want to just do CD Junior again?
Double juicy CD Junior. Man, you're grinding my gears here, bruv. Like,
yeah, but he was my pick. Because the one thing, like, it's not a blow-up, but, like, he is kind of a downer in stream chats. Like, he really is just kind of annoying in stream chats about the game. And it's like, if you don't like the game, like, why are you watching it?
Yeah, that's the thing, yeah. He's literally got a fuckboy complex about him, innit?
Yeah. Yeah. That's like the perfect opportunity.
I think the thing is, it's like at Evo, he was talking really big on Twitter, wasn't he? And like talking trash towards certain other players. He didn't make it out of pools for both of his games.
Yeah, he had a really bad Evo. Yeah.
Which is
Did he not make it out of pools for Killer Instinct?
Nope.
No.
Son!
Yeah.
Wow, man, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I've just checked now. It wasn't TFC that Maxter was top 8, so it might have been Summer Jam. Or I might just be going mad. But I swear he was in top 8 recently. He was using Shinnok.
It definitely wasn't Summer Jam. I watched that top 8 again yesterday.
What was before Summer Jam?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember.
TCW? The Commonwealth?
No.
Too early.
That was like...
EGT, maybe?
The Commonwealth was just before the Fan Choice Tournament, so it wasn't that long ago.
Was it the one that one cowboy won?
EGL
even.
Possibly, but I think that's too far back. I'll have to double check which one it was, because I thought it was TFC, but I must have been remembering something different, and I really can't remember. But yeah, carry on, Strykie, with your blow-ups.
But yeah, it's just been a kind of a recurring theme with CD Junior and NRS games, like, since after MK9, or even during MK9 itself, because the thing is, I don't think he's actually won a major tournament in NRS games since MLG Columbus in 2012. Think how far back that is.
I think you're right, actually, yeah. I think you're right. I don't think he has.
And he's, like, riding the namesake of that still. I think maybe, I don't know, maybe that gives us high expectations of him, and we're just, you can't help but want to blow him up, I guess.
I mean, he was really good in MK. I mean, he's an Evo champion, Killer Instinct. Like, you know, his resume, you know, he's got a very good resume. So, you know, it is surprising to see him not really deliver in MKX. You know, his character's back. You know, he's got Jax. Jax is really good. I don't think there's really any argument to be like, oh, you know, my character sucks. It's like, Jax is super good in this game.
Jupiter's certainly been proving that.
Yeah. It's like, you know, he's one of the few that's like, he's always been good. Jax has always been good in this game. Like, there's never really been a point where Jax has been a bad character by any stretch of the imagination. So, you know, but kind of stops with you at the end of the day, with your player. So, anyone else you guys want to talk about? I guess it could be Injustice era players too. I'm just trying to think if there is actually any. But, like, Injustice era players seem to be doing pretty well for themselves. So,
the key ones are, yeah. There's a lot more that I'm missing, though. Whether they've just dropped the game or are busy with real life, whatever, but...
Yo, what's that? That Foxy a good Grandpa guy, he sucks.
Who's that?
Yeah, the Foxy Grandpa, that guy is trash.
Yeah, he needs to get good. He needs to stop getting hit.
He needs to stop winning against me. I was like, he did something so unsafe against me online, and I was like, I got you now! And then he just, like, jumps back and then EX dive kicks me. I'm like, you motherfucker!
Should have punished that.
Yeah, should have punished that, man.
Should have punished that.
I couldn't! but real talk, he's doing really well, and also congrats to him as well for the recent sponsorship at Problem X Productions. Promotions, isn't it? Yeah, Problem X Promotions, that's the one.
Yeah. Again, so you mentioned some Injustice players, like, who are the ones you're missing?
Well, I mean, there's a few that obviously that made their names via Injustice who were... Assuming we're going to be around for MKX, but however, not playing a game or dropped it because they didn't like it, etc. Like Theo's example, he seemed to have gone off the radar. I don't know if he even played the game. I don't really see White Boy much in tournaments. Maybe he does.
Oh, Detroit Ballin.
Actually, it's another one for.
Yeah, that's another one. Yeah, it's a good one.
He didn't do too bad at Evo. He got top 16, I think.
Yeah, he's done well, but definitely not kind of up there with MK9. Like, you know,
he doesn't really travel much. Like, yeah, for fighting games in general.
I can't really remember what, like, for whatever reason he didn't play Injustice, so.
Because it's a fuck boy game.
Yeah. I don't think KDZ is doing as well as I thought he would be either.
No.
Yeah, well, I was going to say KDZ. That's a good show.
I love KDZ.
KDZ is probably, like, one of the best villains, like, this community.
He is literally one of the coolest people I've ever met.
He's probably, like, the best villain. Like, the KDZ, like, post-Evo, like, chapter of Injustice was amazing. Like, it was so good. It was really good.
Do you think KDZ could rock the NWO theme?
Nah, I think KDZ should have, like,
I feel like, take nah, it's school the, theme. The NWO, you know,
like,
theme.
Like, the dark, like, gothic music, that's what KDZ should have.
KDZ like, should have just Kane's old intro.
That would be tight. Yeah, except Kane's music.
But, like, the NWO theme just fits, like, you know, like, the top performers of Injustice at the break. Like, all Jupiter, right. Darth Arma, like, those guys.
That gives me a great idea for a quick bonus segment, alright? Players in the NRS scene, if they were going to have, like, a wrestler's theme music, who would it be?
Well, let's be real. Okay,
we need to go. We need to come up with some players. So let's try. Okay,
Sonic Fox would have Rey Mysterio's.
I could see that. Yeah, I could see that. Who else we got? What about MIT? What would MIT have? What would his be?
MIT's would just be like straight up the Undertaker theme. No, that would be DJT. DJT's would be the Undertaker theme. MIT's.
Which Undertaker theme?
Like the bells tolling.
Yeah, yeah, the old school one. Yeah.
I was gonna say the one he had when he was like Big Evil was pretty dank.
That probably goes past my point in wrestling, but
yeah, I stopped watching wrestling years and years ago.
What about Tom Brady? What would Tom Brady have?
Tom Brady would have Shawn Michaels' intro. There is no doubt.
Oh, that's a good shout. I think my first thought for Tom Brady was the main part of it is I'm a Real American.
Oh, wasn't that Kurt Angle?
It's Hulk Hogan. No.
Kurt Angle's was just the one.
It might have been Hulk Hogan. Yeah, I think that's what Tom Brady would have.
Oh my God, you know what CD Jr. would have?
What?
Eddie Guerrero's.
I can't remember Eddie Guerrero's.
We lie, we cheat, we steal.
Okay, is that racist?
That is like partially racist, yeah.
Yeah. No, it's not meant to be racist.
Do I need to cut that?
No, I didn't mean it in that sense.
Her Majesty's edits.
Yeah, man.
No. Oh my God. Yeah. I've just dug myself a grave.
That's a good one, though. Oh, I had another one there. What about Rio? What would Rio have?
Who's Mexican?
Talk down, what the hell's going on here?
Alright, now that's. Alright, this is all Strykie's fault.
Yeah. Rio. Okay, yeah. What do you guys think?
Has anyone, like. Does anyone know who Santino Moreno is?
Yes.
No.
He's Italian. Well, I just said the Mexican thing as a lineup because I know it rustles his jimmies.
I feel like Forever King would have the Big Show entrance. Like, he won two majors in a row, one with Gore.
That's a good one, yeah.
He comes in like, whoa, yeah, it's the Big Show! That'd be awesome.
I'm trying to think of one for Rio. I think Triple H is the game one to be pretty good. That would be pretty
He just
tight.
Gets on stage in top 8, spits water out everywhere, yeah. Flexes.
Just goes and sits down. Please, puts his hood up.
The thing is, I can't actually apply the Stone Cold intro to anyone considering that's just fit K Brad too perfectly, even if he doesn't play the game.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know if anybody's really kind of badass enough.
Like, no one can step up.
Yeah. Who else is there? What about Katana Prime? What would his entrance music be?
Let me message Hollow and ask him what his brother's favorite music is.
Oh my days.
Fair enough.
Nah, but Katana Prime's...
What would his be?
That's a hard one, actually.
Alright, we'll come back. What about Zyfox? I've got a good one for Zyfox.
Zyfox would just be the Booker T intro.
That's not bad, actually. I was going to pick Mankind's entrance, just because the first part of the music's a car crash. That's pretty hard. That's pretty apt.
Damn.
What about, UK players? What would the Twins have?
Oh,
I feel like Ketchups would be Raining Blood by Slayer.
There would be the
Dubby Boys. If it was a song to have.
Dubby Boys. That's too good. That's too good.
I feel like all of P&D should just have, the DX intro. Whatever it was.
Oh,
the
that would be kind of fitting, yeah. What about Madsen? What would Madsen have? What would Madsen's entrance
be? Madsen's would just be I don't even know, man. He wouldn't even have a wrestling intro. He would have his own custom song that just involved, I don't even know, man. God Save the Queen
it. Yeah, hang on. I swear there's a, wrestler that's got that in their intro somewhere.
Madsen would just have Kurt Angle's intro, easy.
That's too, you know, like...
It's too legit, actually.
Too legit, yeah. Yeah. Who would have Kurt Angle's entrance music?
Dread.
Dread would be fucking Kofi Kingston, isn't it?
I don't even know who that is.
That's just too good. Dread having his entrance. What are the UK ones, is there? Let's do ourselves. Well, Gabe, what would you want as your entrance music?
Since I seem to be a representative of many female characters, maybe the Godfather's music could be pretty good for me.
The Godfather?
Oh, that's a good... Yeah, do you remember the Godfather?
I do, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good one. Strykie, what about you?
I think this
would be like the most grime intro there is. Like, easy.
I get told that before he cut his hair, I used to get told that I look like CM Punk.
That's it.
That goes past my time.
Isn't that like This Fire Burns by Killswitch Engage or something?
Yeah.
And after that, he had the Dakota personality.
Yeah, nice.
Maybe that'd be up my alley.
Yeah, cool. Falkunn, what about you? What would yours be?
Mine would be just like, I just walk into the tournament. It's like, here comes the money. Like, dog bills hanging up my underwear and stuff.
Shame of man, if you didn't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, shame of man. God, he sucked.
Okay, here's a good one, in reverse. Who would be...
Joe's would be the Rikishi intro.
Who's that?
I can't remember, but I remember being awful.
I don't remember.
Who would have the Hurricanes entrance theme?
I can't even remember that now.
Stand back! There's a hurricane.
Oh no! You know what Joe would have? He would have Sting's entrance. And Joe would just come in from like above with like a bat in hand and everything with makeup.
Bat in hand.
I'm still laughing at the Dudley Boys thing.
I feel like, the Dudley Boys were fucking godlike. I hope they listen to this. Who else is there? Like, who would have a... Who is the most likely one to have a manager in either scene, UK or US? Who is the most likely player to have a manager, like, come out with them to a match?
Well, I mean, Sonic Fox is the closest to that with his buddies. They come up...
I mean, he already kind of has it, so...
I don't know who would likely have a manager, but... I will 100% guarantee that DMS would be the manager.
that's a good one.
Yeah. I feel like DMS would be KDZ's manager if he ever played the game, like, and made, like, placed high consistently. No disrespect intended.
Manager status confirmed.
I'd want DMS to be my manager.
That was such a bill. Why did they ever do that in wrestling? Like, managers.
Dude, who even knew? Wrestling was all about the, like, the backdoor entertainment of, like, the whole who slept with whose wife, all that drama.
I don't follow it anymore, but, like, from what I
That's
hear,
all I remembered
like,
of
it's,
it.
It's definitely, like, it's a lot more kind of kid-friendly now, though. Like, they don't really do stuff like that anymore, do they?
Oh my, how did we miss it? How did we miss the John Cena intro?
That goes to Foxy, because he always fucking wins.
Yeah, fair enough.
It'd have to be the version where that kid's playing it with the recorders through his nose. that'd be amazing.
Anyway, moving on. Let's get it back to the game. Because we don't want to get off topic. Heaven forbid. But the next topic, Kenshi. Let's talk about Kenshi, because we've got Falkunn on the show. I mean, for God's sake, there's now actually a petition.
I've seen the petition.
Buffs, like... So, any other community should take this as a good sign. No other community ever in the NRS community will ever win, like, worst character community, because this has now happened. Like, so, take that as whatever you can, because even though, like, I'm well aware it's only one person, it doesn't matter. Something this bad, like, that's going to be the Kenshi community now.
Like, basically, right, my incentive to drop Kenshi was, I played him, I was fairly content with him, you know, made fifth at the Invitational at MCM, did all that sort of stuff, fairly decent, sort of, I mean, I never really get in those higher up places and stuff, kind of, like, felt like, it was down to me playing as a player, and then I came around to versus fighting. Mm-hmm. I was playing Madsen in my hotel room, I was bopping a Sub-Zero all the time with Kenshi. We get into the tournament, he's like, he looks at me, he's like, you know I'm not playing Sub-Zero against you, I'm like, I know. And then I proceed to get literally annihilated by his blood god, Kotal Kahn. And then I get sent to losers. So I was like, okay, play through losers. Play up against a player named Zero, I believe, who played war god Kotal Kahn. Zoro, is it? Okay, played against him, and I got destroyed by his Kotal Kahn. So I got knocked out of versus fighting by Kotal Kahn. Twice. Well, knocked into losers, and then knocked out. And I was like, yeah, Kenshi sucks. And
maybe that's just a bad matchup.
No, it was just like Kenshi sucks. Because I just generally felt like he was too limited. I think playing before versus fighting came up, like playing casuals against people and stuff like that, I just didn't really feel like he was all that. I miss MK9 Kenshi because he was so good.
But I imagine you do.
Because Kenshi was my favorite Mortal Kombat character, and it just felt like it hurt me to drop him. Because I've never really dropped a character I've been so loyal towards. But
did you play him in DA?
I played him in every single MK. Since
He's only been in like three.
He was in DA, he was in Deception for a while. Was he in Deception?
I believe so.
And then he was in Armageddon.
But everybody, Armageddon doesn't count, literally, because there's Armageddon, every fucking MK.
Yeah, well, he's still in it.
Still a game, well, still counts.
Like that's like saying, oh man, yeah, he was in
either
Armageddon.
Either way, though, I mean, Deadly Alliance so came out years everybody. Ago. So, like.
Yeah, Armageddon is just kind of like a.
Armageddon's amazing. I had a custom character that looked like Beautiful Joe, and he was godlike. But.
We talk about Beautiful Joe, that game's tight.
Yeah, real talk. But Kenshi just felt like kind of, you know, he just, I don't know, I just didn't like him. I really didn't like him in this. I kind of tried to force myself to like him in this game for a while, because he kind of suited how I wanted to play, which is just like, you know, play a spacing game, kind of zone him out a bit, that sort of stuff. But at the same time, I want to be able to have good enough normals to really, like, help me poke out of pressure and things like that.
I do think that's one of his issues, his normals.
They just suck.
Do you think
like,
he's
his
unviable?
Down four is decent. I don't feel like Kenshi's unviable per se. He's just a lot of work. Like, I mean, Pig of the Hut beating Foxy at ESL, like, is a good example that like Kenshi can win matches that prove to be hard for him. It's just a lot of work. But even then, that's down to the two players using the characters. But character does, it's a factor within this. It's weird, though, I'm saying this because I won out for Blood with Kenshi, but that's only because it was up against a Sub-Zero, and the matchup's fine for me. But most of the time, I just feel like Kenshi can actually deal with a lot of things, especially without meter. Like, if you're not actually able to build that much meter, like, without losing so much health, if someone's up in your face all the time, like, how are you going to do it? Special moves, they're up in your face. It's like you don't have the meter to EX Rising Karma them, and you just get blown up for it, and that's just pretty much how it is. I don't really like it. I heard a rumor that Piggy the Hut dropped Kenshi as well.
Right, apparently he's just like quit the game competitively, at least.
Yeah, that's the size of it, pretty much. He's just not compelled to travel.
But he's. Yeah, then again, he is. He's a family man, isn't he? So,
yeah, I mean, he sounds, like, super busy, so...
Yeah, it's a shame. I mean, he was certainly a Kenshi player I looked up to a lot. I didn't get a chance to play MK9 competitively because I was too young at the time. And when Injustice was, like, the first competitive NRS game I played. So, either way, though, I don't know, like, I looked up to Pig of the Hut a lot. I used to just follow him. I guess he just sort of, seeing him play made me kind of, you know, have faith in Kenshi. I kind of just wanted to stick by it. Hopefully something good happens. It just felt like too much. It just felt like I'm not going to get the results I want to get if I'm being held back by my character. As lame as that may sound, it does come down to me as well. Like, not underperforming, playing badly, like getting outplayed, you know, things like that, making mistakes. It comes down to me more than anything. But I just felt like I wanted a character who I can kind of rely on, if that makes any sense.
That's fair enough. I mean, like, do you think, is it just the normals? Like, is that the main issue?
His normals, his spirit charge on block was punishable by quite a fair bit, or it would just give leeway to the enemy.
What, the shoulder charge?
Yeah. And it either gave leeway to someone on block, or it was punishable. I mean, Jax could dash punch it. Kung Lao could, like, run forward too. Which I don't think, I can't remember if it punished it, but it certainly put him in a position that he wanted to be in.
Yeah, because like your pressure's over, basically.
They need to do is just bait the EX Rising Karma or something, or just force you to be so patient you just can't use it. You know, like, good players like Foxy and stuff like that, right? Like, really, really, like, players that can just get in your head. Like, even if you don't let them get in your head, they can still shut you down. They can shut down all options you have. Because you know he's going to throw tech. you know if you're going to try and do anything like an EX Rising Karma and wake up, he's going to bait it, or he's just going to hit you. I mean, if you're doing it after the 1-1-2 and 2, it's like, why are you doing that? It's just, you're going to lose the armor. But things like that, I just felt like he just couldn't deal with much. That's it. His normals were just trash. His specials were kind of meh. They weren't trash, but they were amazing. Stuff like that.
What do you think he needs?
I just feel like he needs a faster down one, and then like a better charge, like a better spare charge.
Define better. Like, what would you want it to be?
Either faster startup, or less negative on block.
So but either
only a hint. Yeah, not both. Yeah. Both would be too much. But just, I mean, the way I played him was, I said this earlier, didn't I? I just keep myself at shoulder range, and I can run in a back three, I can go in for a grab, or I can just shoulder. But that's only going to work against a handful of people, I believe. Mm-hmm. I don't feel like, yeah, that's not a foolproof strategy that's going to work all the time. It's not some kind of metagame with Kenshi. It's just something that just happened to work because TQT was unfamiliar with it. That's it.
Do you think he's the worst in the game?
It's hard to say.
I know it's hard to, like, you know, determine really, the worst, but, like,
yeah, because like, everyone's good in their own respects. I feel like if the Kenshi was to be viable, it would be through Kenjutsu.
Yeah.
But overall, I just find him pretty garbage.
Fair enough. Strykie, Gabe, do you disagree? Agree?
I think his suggestions are reasonable, but I will ask you this, Falkunn. How do you feel about the current flurry situation? The recovery frames were reduced to 43 rather than 53.
Yeah, but like, when are you going to do flurry after a block string? What else is it used for? It's -9 on block. You're going to, like, what, back 3-2 if they block it. You're just going to flurry to keep yourself, like, -9, but you build a decent amount of meter because you're doing it a special on block. That's kind of it. Like, if you're going to throw it out at screen, it's going to get ducked, and they're going to run in. If they jump at full screen, A, what are they doing? B, you can use flurry, but the third hit won't connect with them, and it won't give you the hard knockdown, so it's better to just do the overhead katana.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of it. I don't feel like it's amazing.
It's just like looking through the Kenshi forums, that's one of the biggest pet peeves they have. They want it to have something like 20 frames of recovery, and it's supposedly just so Cassie won't be able to whiff punish him from full screen. I don't buy that, because if you want to say flurry, I personally whiff punish you all the time for that, right?
Yep. And the moment someone does whiff punish me once with it, if they're going to duck it, I'm not going to do it again. It's just, it's way too unsafe. It's like -50. Was it -52 or 54 on whiff?
It's -43 now. And like, as I say, I whiff punish you for that all the time.
Yeah, and all you need to do is teleport.
Even I've noticed it's become harder to whiff punish. So I don't buy like necessarily making it 20 frames of recovery. It's like,
it's not really harder to whiff punish. It's just about doing it instantly. I mean, I know you have the reactions for it. Plenty of people have the reactions for it. It's just the moment you see his hand come out and you're just neutral ducking, you can just EX teleport for free, or you can just run in.
Yeah, Scorpion can actually run in forward through and do that.
My thing is this, it's like, if they want a safer flurry, why not go with Possessed? Granted, Scorpion can still punish that, but it will still cover a lot of bases for other matchups.
Possessed also rules in the negativities of his normals being bad. Because you may have better special moves, but if your normals aren't good enough and they're in your face, what are you going to do? It's the same thing, really. And you're sacrificing a lot of damage.
So would better normals actually be like the overall better buff?
I feel like a faster down one, maybe. Or something like that could benefit him quite a fair bit. But I don't even know, man. It's hard to say, because I just don't really want to go back to him. The only reason I'll ever go back to him is if for some reason he was as good as he was in MK9. That's it. There's nothing else that would really convince me.
I feel like that's a common opinion.
But then again, he was top tier in MK9.
Yeah, that's fucking stupid. He was broke as
fuck. He was ridiculous. You just need to keep yourself in shoulder range and just like either back two, run forward three, or just shoulder them, EX shoulder, shoulder, that sort of garbage.
It's like that, like, I can't say I've ever seen that said on the forum in those exact words, to be honest, but like, if that is a mindset or a condition, it's like, so you know, you want a character that basically decimates 90% of the cast.
Okay? Yeah, I mean, like, he was fairly brain dead in MK9. You know, I mean, he wasn't necessarily that easy to play, but
he kind of was,
but he was brain dead.
But I think that's a bit of a, you know, it's like, okay, well, you don't want much, do you? It's like, wow, you know, you're not asking for a lot, are you?
Yeah, that's why, like, if I were to ever have any Kenshi changes that I feel like would make him a beneficial character towards people who want to play him now is just, you know, just that. Just maybe some better normals. That's it. Just faster normals.
Okay. I agree. I think, that's the point, actually. Did any of you guys see Porkchop play?
Porkchop. Yeah, he played Kenshi against Mike Metroid, I believe.
Yeah. And he did pretty well. Like, the one thing I noticed in those matchups he had, there were quite a few teleflurries that went unpunished. Like, there was quite a lot. Like, there was a couple at, like, ranges where, like, maybe they weren't comfortable with, which is fine, but there were a couple that were, like, kind of just outside of dash range, and I was thinking, okay, that should definitely get punished.
Kenshi's best three tools are his EX Rising Karma, his down four, and his, thingy. Crap. What is it? I lost it. It was on the top of my head. All right. He has EX Rising Karma, which is an amazing reversal, if used correctly. His down 4 is actually pretty good. Oh, crap, what else was it? His Reflect. His Reflect is really good.
Yeah, he has got a good Reflect.
I mean, like,
so, like, none of his special moves, basically. Would you prefer, if it was either or, like, would
his
you
his overhead katana's moves? Decent, but I just, overall, like, his shoulder's a bit naff, his teleflurry's garbage, and that's kind of it.
Yeah.
But that's just balanced. I mean, Possessed, I don't really want to try and make Possessed work. It's too much. It's not bad, but you're very limited, and it's quite gimmicky. Whereas with, if any any Kenshi variation would be viable, I just think it's Kenjutsu.
Yeah.
Just because you have, like, a full screen free punish for something.
Yeah,
you
like
have,
his grab thing is
it's
really good.
Really good. You have a true 50-50, even though it doesn't lead to a lot of damage, it's, you know, there. Mm. You have just stuff like that. But Kenshi doesn't really have the advantage of things like, you know, like, string staggering into grabs, like that kind of mix up.
Yeah, I feel like if you have that in this game, it's really good for you. If you have like a couple of, even if you have one, but like if you have a couple of strings where it's like, okay, I'm gonna do this and then I'm gonna do
yeah,
this,
it's like Aaron Black, for example, right? Like Aaron Black can just go like 1-1 and then into grab, or he can go like 1-1 back three. It's like, and then
or
if you block that, he can tick
like,
throw
you.
You
think he's gonna grab like 1-1, 2-1, 1-2, 2 or something? It's like,
yeah.
You know, and all the while he's doing this, it's like, God, his meter's just going up and up and up.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it is annoying. So, moving on to the last topic now. I kind of touched on it a little bit there, though. I think this is one that Gabe came up with, and it was a really good one. I wanted to end on it. With how the game works, like, do you guys think it's fair? Like, when people ask for, you know, like, kind of unfair buffs for their characters so they can compete with, you know, the kind of unfair characters in the game, the top tier. Like, do you guys think that's, like, fine? Like, if everything was to be kind of be done like that, like, you know, if they buffed Kenshi to where he was kind of stupid, but, you know, left nobody at the bottom, you know, basically just made
so you're saying everyone was just really good?
Everybody was just really good, yeah. Like, you know, what if everybody was just absolutely bonkers?
I feel like, as opposed to that, everyone should just be normalized.
I agree. I think having, like, you know, like,
but if something were to come into effect where characters, like, maybe everyone was, like, top tier or something, right? Like, that would be cool, but it would be hard to do that. You have to kind of take every little, like, micro detail into account for that.
I think as well, if you do that, I think the danger is, like, inevitably there's probably still going to be a handful of characters that are
it would solely come. It would solely come down to, I wouldn't, maybe I agree there, but, like, that would just be a sheer fact of, like, how your character's tools fare with the other character's tools. That's it.
whereas how much bullshit can you throw at them before they throw it at you?
I've got an idea on this, actually. Like, we'll break our own characters. Melina, Gabe, what would you do, like, to, you know, make Melina, you know, kind of, you know, MKX top tier? What would you change?
The only thing you really need to do is just give her a low roll, and that'll be it.
Yeah. Fair enough.
That essentially makes every single string 50-50, which she's got meter. 50-50 on wake up, whenever you knock her down. And essentially, all you have to do is really stand about two-thirds away from the screen, and then you control the neutral, because anything your opponent does, just throw out roll, launches into a combo.
Yeah.
That is it.
You could
everything else would just be a bonus.
You could punish almost everything with it as well. Like, it's like 7 frames, isn't it?
8.
Is it 8?
Well, yeah, 8 with an asterisk next to it.
Yeah, quotes, really. Inbound again.
Yeah, doesn't really work. Strykie, what about you for Scorpion? Like, make him broke.
Armor on the Xpier, stay safe.
That wouldn't be my choice.
Alright, hit me.
I like it. To make him, like, kind of, you know, dumb, I would either say armor on EX Aura or a safe teleport.
Oh, fuck. Safe
teleport.
What about EX Hellfire doing damage over time?
You know, I'm kind of disappointed that Hellfire doesn't do that. But it depends how much, because at the moment, like, it really bugs me that Hellfire's minus on hit. I know it's unblockable, but it's not a lot of damage, and it's minus on hit. Like, so
yeah.
you hit
so
your
strange.
Opponent. Like, you hit your opponent, but your go is over. It's like, what? Wait, what? Like, that doesn't... Like, and the move is kind of a risk. Like, you know, if someone reads that, or it's like, or I don't say reacts to it, because you can't really react to it, but, you know, it's like you're risking, like, you know, 6% for, like, basically a full combo. It's like, and I'm not even plus on hit. But, like, it depends how much it did, because if it did too much, then, you know, then you get into the realm of, well, this move is unblockable, and, like, you know, how much is fair for an unblockable move to do? Like, I mean, Jax's ground pounds when not in pumped up, are they blockable? I can't remember. I don't think they are they?
No. They're unblockable.
No. You get hit by one of them, he can do over 30%. It's unblockable. Like, you get hit by Scorpion's unblockable.
And then Tremors, Earthshaker as well. That's unblockable. It's like Hellfire's is a bit enough. The Hellfire itself.
Hellfire kind of EX Hellfire can OTG, which is nice. So, but yeah, I don't know what you'd do with Hellfire, but damage over time would be nice. But yeah, I'd give him armor on EX Aura. I think that'd probably be all he needed to be like really stupid, because it's very rare that EX that Aura gets beat out anyway. Like, and when people try and beat it out with, like, a jump one, like, you just EX Aura, and they get armored. It's like, yeah, you can't do anything.
Just imagine if they changed the properties so that every single move involving fire did damage over time. So instead of the EX Aura, it was more like a flame barrier, so that if someone got caught by it, it would do damage over time. You know, kind of like Venomous in a sense.
Yeah,
that'd be interesting.
Like, how much damage, though, I think is the...
Speaking of Aura, actually, how about this? I think I came up with this at Versus Fighting, just for a laugh. What if he activated the Aura, and whenever you got close to him, it burned you straight up, and you got a combo right there and then.
Oh, so like, basically, like the hit advantage, like, was always active.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, I'd take that, dude. You could just pop Aura full screen and just run at them.
Yeah.
Okay, you can teleport into them on purpose.
Yeah.
It just burn them right there.
They try and so if they try and hit you, would they get set on fire?
Pretty much, yeah.
Very, yeah.
So basically, it would kind of be like Jason's unstoppable thing, but if you touch him, like, you literally get set on for, dude, that would be sick. I think that might actually be, then everybody would just main Scorpion. Like,
yep.
Imagine your fucking mirrors?
We'd have all these wannabe Scorpions. It would basically be like Hellfire trades, wouldn't it? Like, you'd both light Aura on, and you'd start jumping to try and bait, like, Hellfire.
Apollo Prime would come back to the game.
Oh, man. That would be cool. I'd like that. Falcon, what about you for your characters? Yeah, you can either choose any of them, Tanya, Predator, Kenshi.
Well, I don't really play much Predator. I don't put that much time into him.
Give him two cannons. Give him two plasma cannons.
The low EX shot and the straight EX shot at the same time. Now with Tanya, I think the only thing I would say was, you know her EX projectile after a block string, just remove the armor gap in between that. So when it hits, when it goes past, and when it comes back, just get rid of the armor gap that someone can freely, like EX spin, for example, through that. Yeah, so it just becomes a true block string. Either that, or when you do it, Tanya is still mobile, because it freezes you in place.
Yeah.
So if you could back 1, 2+4 into EX Tanfa, like the Tanfa throw, and then you could do back 1, 2+4 again, and it comes back and hits them. It's like, you know, just like a true block string in a way. Something like that, and that's it.
That's fair enough. Anything else you guys want to talk about or plug or anything before we wrap up, as that was the last topic?
Not from my side.
Okay. Strykie, Falcon, anything you want to quickly plug or shout out?
Just go back on that topic, actually. Just to maybe stretch it for one last thing. Falcon.
Hey, man. Host is a Scorpion player. Floor is yours, my friend. Give me these insane buffs.
No, I want to know what Falcon had in store for Kenshi specifically. Immortal was already halfway there with the
only way you can make Kenshi top tier in this game is if you make him like MK9. That is it. Either that, or if you gave Kenshi a faster startup and a shoulder charge, and you gave him MK9's back too, that would be enough. And like maybe a faster down one, only by like one or two frames. That's it. Like, that would instantly make him, like, ridiculously good, I think. Because if his shoulder charge was, like... Well, it was, like, a 10-frame startup, wasn't it? In MK9. Imagine if it was like that in this game. And then he had his overhead back, too. Which you can't combo off of, but it's there. And he had... That would just be good. And he could just, like... His down one was faster. That would just make him a really good character, I think.
Yeah. Fair dues. I was going to say, did you ever see that thread where Immortal said that EX Rising Karma should be plus on block?
Yeah, I thought it was one of the stupidest things I've ever read. No disrespect to Immortal, but that's silly. There's no reason an armored reversal that gives you 28% should be plus on block. There's literally no reason. On top of that, if you include the pushback it has, what's the point of being plus on block? Like, if you're going up to someone and you say, for example, you did like 4-2-1 EX Rising Karma, or like back 3-2 EX Rising Karma, it's going to push him back far enough for you not to be able to do anything. If it's like, say, for example, it was like plus 12, what are you going to do? You can shoulder them. That's it.
Yeah.
That becomes a block string, but then they can punish the shoulder. You can't really do much else. It just kind of sends you back to the neutral game. Maybe safe is something, but that's it. Not plus.
Yeah, fair dues. It was just like funny to me how in that thread he was just so bewildered that everyone was blowing him up for it.
He was quite adamant that it should have been plus on block, but I don't agree with that in the slightest. I'm sure many Kenshi players would love that. It would be useless, that's the thing. It would literally have no use.
Speaking of that, did you guys see King Hippo's thread?
Yeah.
The unsolved mystery, that was godlike. Hippo's one of my favorite posters on TYM. He's really good at regulating shit.
He is an underrated poster, I think.
He is, yeah. He's very underrated. He is really good. Falcon, anything you want to plug or shout out before we go?
Oh, yeah. I have new sponsorship news coming soon. It's going to be pretty hype. That's all. I don't even know why I'm sponsored. I suck, but, you know, still.
Obviously not. Getting sponsored.
Fair enough. Gabe, anything you want to shout out or anything?
No, nothing to shout out about, really. I guess maybe you mentioned for people who might be listening who are considering going to Red Fight District, you should probably go.
Oh, yeah.
It's the next big European tournament.
Yep, it's not far away now either. It's, what, in 2 weeks?
Yep.
I think. Yep, 2 weeks. Yep, definitely check that out.
I'd like to give DJT a shout-out for having the best concentrating face ever, and I want that on a T-shirt. like, you know, like completely leaning back, lazy eyes, like eyelids released, like chilled out, tongue out, everything.
DJT's faces are pretty godlike.
Is the best. Yeah.
He has the best faces in the NRS scene, for sure.
I love it.
Blake has some pretty good faces, actually. Mm-hmm. On that note, Blake has some really good ones. But yeah, DJT's a pretty godlike as well. Strykie, anything you want to shout out before we sign off?
I'd say I'm about good for now. Just want to give a shout out to my new local team, Legacy of Minds. I got signed up last month. Keep it classy, actually. I haven't had a chance to give them a shout out since. It's not really a major team, like a sponsorship team. It's just something that's done locally to help each other level up. And as I say, it's just a community thing. We're not looking for money. It's just for the future of our fighting game interests and fighting games in general. So shout out to them.
Cool. Right, guys. Well, thanks for tuning in. We will see you in the next episode, whenever that ends up being. Probably after Red Fight District, I imagine, pending. I hope there's a stream for that, actually.
There will be.
Yeah, I really hope there is. And we'll catch you then. Take care.